Hello, everybody, and welcome to my virtual Sunday school class. How is everyone doing? It's kind of hot and muggy outside, but this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be exceedingly glad in it. Excuse me. Thank you for listening. The title for our class today is Spiritual Practices for Christian Leaders. This is a wonderful, wonderful class, okay? And the first thing we're going to look at is the lesson overview, okay? So here is the lesson overview. Now, what's the central truth of our lesson? Okay. Christian leaders must live as a holy example to all. What's the focus of our lesson? Consider and practice a lifestyle that is appropriate for Christian leadership. Aha! It's so important that Christian leaders not just talk the talk, but they walk the walk. Okay, and then the evangelism emphasis is personal holiness among leaders is a witness to the world, okay? All right, so let's go on and look at the golden text for our class today. The golden text is coming from 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 16, and it's coming from the King James Version, okay? Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine, continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. Hallelujah! And with that, we're going to begin with our worship song. And the title of our worship song is, I Know Who Holds Tomorrow. This song has been pre-recorded by me. Okay, y'all can sing along if you like.
I don't know about tomorrow. I just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry for the future, for I know what Jesus said, and today I'll walk beside him, for he knows what is ahead. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Every step is getting brighter as the golden stairs I climb. Every burden's getting lighter. Every cloud is silver. sun is always shining. There's no tear that dims the eye. At the ending of the rainbow, where the mountains touch the sky.
Hallelujah! Father, I want to thank you, for this is the day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be exceedingly glad. Rejoice in the Lord, and again I say rejoice. And Father, the reason why we can truly rejoice is our names have been written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank you for that. Thank you that he who knew no sin became sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So we praise you, we magnify your name, we glorify your name. Thank you that you are able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or even think, according to your power that works within us, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we praise you and we magnify your name, Lord. Thank you, Father, that you have not given us a spirit of fear, but a power and of love and of a sound mind. And Father, we can come casting all our cares upon you, Lord, for you care so much for us. You loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son, Jesus, to die on the cross for our sins and to be raised from the dead. Thank you that Jesus is coming back soon, Lord. And Father, we pray even right now that you help us to be closer to him and to be prepared for his coming, Lord. Hallelujah. And Lord, now I come to you for my virtual Sunday school class. I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto you, O Lord, my Savior and my Redeemer, Lord. I pray for the precious anointing of the Holy Spirit, Lord, to help me teach this class. For we ask it in Jesus' matchless name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. All right. Okay. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to go to the... we'll look at the golden text, we've already looked at the golden text. Let's go to the scripture overview, okay? So here's the scripture overview. Point number one is keep yourself pure. And the scriptures are coming from 1 Timothy 4, 7 through 8, 2 Timothy 2, 19 through 21. And they're all coming from the NIV version. Commit, point number two, commit to study and doctrine. 1 Timothy 4, 15 and 16, and then 2 Timothy 3, 14 through 17. And point number three, disciplines complementary to leadership. 2 Timothy 2, 22 through 26. Hallelujah. All right. And with that, let's go to the introduction of our class, okay? So here's the introduction for our class. If you'll just give me a second. All right, so here is the introduction for our class today, okay? Many great volumes have been written about leadership development, but most have focused on leadership styles and models more than on leadership qualifications. Aha. Okay. And we're talking about spiritual practices for Christian leaders. Okay. So, all right. We sometimes assume anybody who works hard enough can become a leader. When it comes to Christian leadership, however, certain practices are necessary to build a moral, ethical, and spiritual foundation for successful ministry. Sadly, some Christian leaders have crashed and burned because their charisma took them further than their character could sustain them. Aha! Significantly, did you hear that? What happened? Their charisma took them farther than their character could sustain them. Ah! So these individuals are very gifted, but they had not developed their character, so they crashed and they burned. Okay. Significantly, the scripture calls us to be disciples of Christ. A disciple is more than a fan of Christ. A disciple is a true follower, one who is daily disciplined in both faith and practice. This lesson will consider some of the essential lifestyle practices and disciplines that are for Christian leaders. Aha! All right, so we're going to begin with point number one, and that is keep yourself pure. And the scripture is coming from godliness last, from 1 Timothy 4, 7 through 8, okay? So let's go there. Here we go. 1 Timothy 4, chapter 4, 7 through 8, and I'm reading from the NIV version. Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. Hallelujah! Scripture says, godliness plus contentment equals great gain. And we have twisted that equation around and said, godliness plus great gain equals contentment. And that's where we have seen many leaders in Christian ministry crash and burn because they had lack of character, okay? All right, let's look at these scriptures in greater detail, okay? All right, the grave importance of the study is introduced by Paul's strong statement in the first verses of 1 Timothy 4. He prophesied what every generation of believers has since seen come to pass, and especially we in our times. Aha! Okay. He warned some would walk away from the true faith in Christ, giving themselves over to doctrines of demons and without shame teach false doctrines. These erring leaders drift so far away from God that their consciences are no longer sensitive to the Holy Spirit, because they perceive themselves more spiritual than others. They impose unbiblical legalistic restrictions on their followers. Aha! Let me repeat that to you, okay? He warned some would walk away from true faith in Christ, giving themselves over to the doctrines of demons. And without shame, teach false doctrines. These erring leaders drift so far away from God that their consciences are no longer sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Their consciences have been seared as with a hot iron, okay? Because they perceive themselves more spiritual than others, they impose unbiblical legalistic restrictions on their followers. Rules and regulations. And they develop a controlling spirit to control and manipulate others, okay? Inasmuch as these false teachers were once on the straight and narrow, this passage provides a disciplinary template so we do not fall into the same snare. I always remind myself, but for the grace of God, you go there. There go I. But for the grace of God, there go I. Observe Paul's contrasting of the positive and the negative. His instructions not only warned Timothy of what he needed to avoid, they also reminded him of what he needed to do. Amen? And later on, I'm going to show you how Scripture itself is balanced. It has positives and it has negatives, and they're both perfectly balanced. Some Christians are well versed about what they do not believe and what they must not do, but lack understanding of the positive virtues needed to develop a godly lifestyle. Oh, help us, Lord. Avoiding certain places and rejecting some practices are essential disciplines for developing in godliness. As believers, we must keep ourselves from ideologies that conflict with Scripture so we might be devoted to the service of Christ. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. James 1 and 27. Hallelujah. Wow. Old Wives' Fables, 1 Timothy 4 and 7, likely refers to ancient superstitions handed down from generation to generation. Most often in biblical times, fathers were occupied from sunup to sundown outside the home, and mothers were the primary educators of the family. Perhaps this is one reason Paul stressed the need for divine order in the home. Ephesians 6, chapter 6, 1 through 4, and Colossians 3, 20 through 21. We don't have time to turn there. Biblical Christian leaders must know the Scriptures. Must know the Scriptures and be guided by them and not by irrelevant folklore and silly myths. 1 Timothy 4 and 7, Amplified Version. Okay? Did you see that? Biblical Christian leaders must know the Scriptures, be guided by them, and not by irreverent folklore and silly myths. 1 Timothy 4:7, Amplified Version. In verse 8, Paul did not speak disparagingly of bodily exercise. Rather, he sought to contrast its value to that of developing godliness. The word translated little suggests the definite article a before little. It is the same word Jesus used in telling the disciples to thrust out a little from the land, Luke 5:6. In order to catch more fish, and when James said, our life is as a vapor that appears for a little time and vanishes away, James 4:14. Physical health is important, for our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit and is not to be defiled. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dwells in us. And no wonder we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Physical health is important, for our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit and is not to be defiled. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. But exercising towards godliness is vastly more important. Now, somebody may ask, what is godliness? Well, godliness can be defined as being devout, conforming to the laws and wishes of God. In a practical sense, it speaks of ethical and moral righteousness or uprightness patterned after Scripture. The word here translated godliness, eusebia, is used in the Greek repeatedly in the letters of Peter and Paul. In Acts 3:12, the Greek word eusebia is translated holiness, which conveys the same truth as godliness. So godliness and holiness are synonymous, okay? All right, let's go on. Point number B, holiness honors God, 2 Timothy 2:19-21. Okay, so here we go. Holiness honors God, 2 Timothy 2:19-21. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription, the Lord knows those who are His, and everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness. Aha! Did you hear that? Let me repeat that. The Lord knows those who are His. And everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness. You can't have one foot in the world and one foot with God. As one preacher pointed out, you can't serve God and play footsie with the devil. Oh, help us, Lord. Okay, so let's look at these scriptures in greater detail and see what they're talking about, okay? The way of godliness is life's most desirable path. Charles Spurgeon said, I assure you, and there are thousands of my brethren who can affirm the same, that after having tried the ways of sin, we definitely prefer the ways of righteousness, for their own pleasure's sake. Hallelujah! Did you hear that? Wow! Wow! Okay? Here's what Charles Spurgeon said. I assure you, and there are thousands of my brethren who can affirm the same, that after having tried the ways of sin, we infinitely prefer the ways of righteousness, for their own pleasure's sake. With all the sorrow and care which Christian life is supposed to bring, we would prefer it to any other form of life beneath the stars. Hallelujah! Committed Christian living is the most satisfying life because it is built on a sure foundation. Verse 19. The earlier verses of this chapter speak of enduring hardness as a good soldier, warring and striving and not becoming entangled with the affairs of this life. Verse 4. Aha! The young minister, Timothy, had to understand that constant spiritual warfare, opposition from within and without, hard spiritual labor, and personal suffering were to be expected. Hallelujah! Preach it, Brother Percy, because we don't preach that in our churches, and the majority of the churches there. Pastors are just there to tickle itching ears. Tickle itching ears. They want to make people just feel comfortable. And it was Vance Havner who said, we should comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. Oh, wow. Wow. Paul experienced them all. Timothy had to silence vain babblings because they eat at the heart of a church like cancer. Verse 16 and 17. He also had to deal with those who are false teachers like Hymenaeus and Philetus. Yet he was not moved by these things. There might be invasions of deceivers, but he stood on the sure foundation that the Lord knoweth them that are his. Hallelujah! As in a rich man's house, there are articles made of various materials, all adapted to the uses for which they are intended. So in the Church of Christ, there are members designed for different tasks. Verses 22 through 21. Though the members of a church differ in capacity, none are to be considered superior to anyone else. Any task in the service of Christ is an honorable task. The scripture says, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. Do you see that? Any task. It's all about service anyway. However, some churchgoers are not vessels of honor. Some are negligent, disobedient, and concerned more for worldly things than for the kingdom of heaven. And sometimes it's all about power and prestige in the church. How sad. This is in some churches. I'm not talking about all churches. These must purge themselves so they are ready for the master's use. Okay? Now, let's talk about out of harm's way. A wealthy businessman was advertising for a driver for his limousine. He narrowed his search down to three finalists and had each of them drive him on a mountain road with a potentially deadly drop-off. Each time he asked the driver, how close can you drive me to the edge without going over? The first two drivers claimed they could drive within a couple feet of the cliff without causing harm. The third driver, startled by the question, said, the issue is not how close can I safely drive you to the cliff. The question is, how can I keep you safely away from the danger of the cliff? This driver got the job. Hallelujah. We're not supposed to get you know, so close to the edge where we could fall off. We should stay far away from the edge. Amen? And that's the moral of that story. Some Christians, including some leaders, try to see how closely they can live to the world and still walk with Christ. Wise believers seek to walk safely away from harm's way. Aha! Next point is, commit to study and doctrine. Okay? So let's go there. I forgot to read the scripture, 2 Timothy 2:19 through 21. In a large house, there are articles not only of gold and silver, okay, but also wood and clay. Some are for special purposes and some for common use, okay? Those who cleanse themselves from the latter will be instruments for special purposes, made holy, useful to the master, and prepared to do any good work. Hallelujah. Now let's go on to the next point and talk about that, okay? All right. Commit to study and doctrine. Keep moving forward. 1 Timothy 4:15 through 16. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourselves wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Hallelujah. Okay. So let's go and look at these scriptures and see what they're talking about, okay? So, the greatest defense against worldliness is a good offense. Did you hear that? The greatest defense against worldliness is a good offense. Godliness does not come about simply because of the things we stop doing or the places we stop visiting, as important as some of those things may be. Rather, godliness is the fruit of a life disciplined through prayer, faithful service, and the study of God's word. Aha! Aha! Did you hear that? Did you hear that? Godliness, let me repeat that. Godliness is the fruit of a life disciplined through prayer, faithful service, and the study of God's word. You know, we can read God's word, but we should go a step beyond that and study the word of God. And the scripture says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Hallelujah. It's context, context, context about the scripture. You have to read the stuff above it. Let's say you're studying about baptism. You should read the scriptures above it. Read the scriptures below it. And then read all the other scriptures that talk about baptism. And those all should be in agreement. Amen? Because scripture seldom contradicts scripture unless there's a good reason. Like it may have been in the old covenant times and may not be applicable because we are under a new covenant. Okay? All right. So let's go on. Paul called Timothy to meditate on God's word. This is not to be confused with mind-emptying meditation of some pagan religions. Oh God, help us. Help us with all this new age philosophy creeping in. And then when you go to countries like India, they talk about meditation too, you know? But what they're talking about is completely different and is anathema to the Christian. Hindu meditation is meant to empty your mind. Amen? But Christian meditation, when you do Christian meditation, you're supposed to fill your mind with the Word of God and the study of the Scriptures. Why? Because if your mind is totally empty, the enemy can put in whatever thoughts he wants to put in and completely deceive you. Hallelujah. And so you see how Hindu meditation is completely the opposite of Indian Christian meditation. And you don't keep on repeating these stupid mantras in Hinduism, you know. No, we fill our mind with the Word of God and we meditate on the Word of God. Okay? Rather, it is a mind-filling practice of studying the Scriptures and the truths to be discerned from them. This is the safest, surest path towards biblical holiness. Because the Scripture says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. But if you don't read the Scriptures and study the Scriptures, how are you going to renew your mind? Amen? Compare this verse to Paul's admonition in Philippians 4 and 8. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, there is any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Hallelujah. Amen. Fill your mind with the good things of God is what those scriptures are saying. All right? Pagan meditation practices bring participants to a standstill while they're secluded in a state of mindlessness. Remember I talked about emptying your mind? While all believers need regular quiet times, Christian meditation does not cause us to withdraw from the world, but rather equips us to go back into the world possessing a godly heart and mind. Amen? In the Christian faith, we are not told to run from the world and live in a monastery. You know, like the Buddhists do and stuff like that. No, we're supposed to be in the world but not be of the world. Because how can you influence the world if you're not in the world? If you're out somewhere in the monastery, you know, you're secluded. You're all by yourself. Or with a few people you have with you, okay? And then how do you fight the thoughts in your mind? Uh-huh. You may flee from the world, but your mind is the battleground. Satan can put all kinds of thoughts in those minds unless you renew your mind continually, okay? Meditating on good and godly things must not be a sporadic hit and miss activity. It must be a priority, and for good reason, take pains with these things. Be absorbed in them so that your progress will be evident to all. 1 Timothy 4 and 15. That comes from the NASB version. While worldly meditation is self-centered or self-conscious, godly meditation has twofold purpose, both self and others. Certainly, we must be self-aware, recognizing our own needs. Christian psychologists and counselors suggest the reason many high-profile pastors and leaders fall into burnout and or sin is because in their zeal to provide pastoral care for others, they neglect their own spiritual disciplines. Jesus asks, what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Mark 8 and 36. New Living Translation. For this reason, Paul exhorted Timothy to take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. We must practice what we preach to save ourselves and others from falling prey to seducing spirits and the doctrines of devils. Aha, that's what the Bible says. Okay? Huh? What is it talking about? Seducing spirits and the doctrines of demons. Doctrines of devils. Let's talk about watering down the gospel for a minute. In business, there's nothing wrong with watering down a strong flavor. But the same impulse leads to disaster in our faith. Like the inauthentic, Americanized style of Mexican food. There is a gospel that is simply not the real thing. The hot, offensive themes, such as the cross and the blood of Christ, are taken out, and a comfortable, people-pleasing substitute is found. The false gospel may be soothing to the taste, but it is powerless to save. The genuine gospel will always be an offense to sinful humankind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's go to point B. Continue in God's word, 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, okay? And we're fast running out of time, okay? But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. But here's verse 16 and 17. One of my favorite scriptures says, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, for rebuking and correcting and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Hallelujah! Notice what it says. All scripture is God-breathed. Remember in the book of Genesis? God breathed into Adam's nostril, and Adam became a living soul. That was the Ruach of God, the breath of God. Amen? So notice what it says. All scripture. It's not just some scripture. It's not just some scripture that we like and we leave out the ones that we don't like or are too convicting. No, it's all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for, notice what it says, teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Notice rebuking and correcting are negatives and teaching and training are positives. So do you see, the word of God itself is balanced. There is balance in scripture. And that's a very important point we should never forget. Amen? So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Hallelujah. Let's go on. And disciplines complementary to leadership. It says, flee lust and foolishness, 2 Timothy 2, 22-23. Flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments, because you know they produce quarrels. And many times people squibble over really trivialities, trivial things. Amen? And that causes fights and quarrels, okay? So it says, don't have anything to do with foolish and stupid arguments. Don't get into stupid arguments, foolish arguments. Because you know they produce quarrels, okay? And the Lord's servant, and this is point B, lovingly correct others. 2 Timothy 2, 24-26. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will give them repentance. Notice what it says. The servant of the Lord cannot be quarrelsome. He must be kind to everyone. He must be able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance, that they would come to their senses and escape the snares of the devil. Amen? Which is what the next scripture says, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. Hallelujah. Oh God, help us, Lord. Help us, God, to have that proper balance. Help us to speak the truth in love, God. Help us to rescue people who have been caught captive by vain philosophies and deceit and the doctrines of demons, Lord. Help us, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that brings us to the completion of our lesson. And we've run out of time. So thank you for listening. And we're going to finish this with the worship song that we were singing, okay?
Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. I don't know about tomorrow, it may bring me poverty, but the one who feeds a sparrow is the one who stands by me, and the path that be my portion may be through the flame or flood, but his presence goes before me, and I'm covered by his blood. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know
who holds tomorrow. And I know who holds my hand. Hallelujah! And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. Shalom. Nothing missing, nothing broken. Thank you for listening. And if you like the broadcast, please put likes and share it with others so more people can get to hear it. Thank you for listening. And if you have any prayer requests, please mention them in the comments or mention them in Messenger. I'll be more than glad to pray for you, okay? Thank you.